I think Leeds United are going to win something this year.
I'm sure they'll win the cup. There isn't a team to touch them.
They're going to win the double.
You have just been listening to a cross-section of Leeds United supporters. Well, I'm Phil Brown, sports editor of the Yorkshire Evening Post at Leeds, and as you will know, I haven't always held the same opinions as the supporters, but this time I do. I think United will win something this season.
No player at Elland Road is better qualified to echo all those hopes than Bobby Collins.
Football is a funny game, and all through it you can be very successful one day and the following day you can be down. And it's the same regarding injuries. I mean, all through my career I've had some bad injuries, but like Alan Peacock, who is another unfortunate player, I've always had this determination to come back. And generally, you sometimes get these injuries when everything's going well, and all of a sudden, bang.
But my career with Leeds United had really come to a stagnation, and I really didn't know what direction I was going in. This is, of course, in all in retrospect. This is looking back now. And then Don Revie came to Leeds United, and Don said to me one day, if I was manager of this club, he said, I wouldn't play you. Because he used to go charging off for corner kicks, play on the ball, run like hell with it and lose it and all sorts of things. I had ability, but I didn't know how to channel it.
Indeed, by 1960, I had come to the conclusion the club had such a poor record, such poor prospects, and such a poor financial footing that only a millionaire mad on football, Mr. Reynolds. Now let us turn to the man that he appointed to take the helm of the club, Don Revie. Don Revie had never managed anything when Mr. Reynolds appointed him. Well, it wasn't quite Mr. Reynolds who appointed him, it was the board. But Mr. Reynolds persuaded the board that Mr. Revie was the man for the vacant job. He never did a better piece of persuasion. No better decision has ever been made for Leeds United by its board than to give its managership to Don Revie. He had a poor inheritance, but he has turned it with unfailing support from the board, that must be stressed every time, into a potential gold mine.
Well, what have we tried to build at Leeds United in the last 5 years? As far as I'm concerned, the first thing we tried to do was build a family spirit that didn't exist in any other club in Britain. By trying to do this, we had to get, first of all, the spirit in the boardroom, where I feel it's so important that if things go right among your board of directors, then things run smooth like throughout your club. Because these are the gentlemen that put money into the club and never get any returns for it. These are the people that either back a manager or don't back him in buying and selling of players, the no interference about team selection or training methods. And I can also say they never interfered once in the 5 years I've been manager here in any of these things. All of them has backed me to the nose and instilled confidence into me to go ahead and do things. Then this has got to see through me personally to the training staff, and from the training staff through to the players, and through to the groundsmen, the ladies in the laundry, and everybody connected with this club. Then, once we'd start to build this spirit, then we had to try and build a team. And we did this by forming a youth policy 5 years ago, trying to find the best young schoolboys in Britain. Now, it's all right finding them, but once they join your club, they've got to believe that your club is ambitious and a club that looks after players. Most of the players in this club are below the age of 23, 24, apart from one or two exceptions. And these, I feel, are the backbone of any club, and we will continue to try and find these great youngsters throughout the country.
And nobody had ever channeled it properly for me. And then Don, strangely enough, within a year was manager of the club. And he brought in people like Les Cocker and Sid Owen, who really were a different type of person than I'd ever met in football. They really made you work. They made you work at your game. It was nothing to be brought back in the middle of the afternoon and to spend a couple of hours just learning to head balls clear, or to track people down, chase people, tackle them, get the ball away from 18-yard boxes. And all the things that were needed to be a centre-half were all taught to you. And this was, remember, at the age of about 25, 26. And Don, in his first year, we nearly got relegated, because that was why he got the job. But we managed to stay in the second division. And at the end of that season, he introduced a lot of the young lads, like Paul Reaney and Billy Bremner and Gary Sprake, and into the first team. And I was virtually his last senior player left at about 26, because all the other young lads were brought into the team at the end of that season. And I was really the senior player, and given quite a lot of responsibility and to the handling of it and how it was run.
Short one! Let go! Oh, Jim, Jim, Jim. Got a flyer. Go!
Watching the hard, relentless pace of Elland Road training sessions, the onlooker could be excused for thinking that the tempo of Saturday matches cannot be more demanding in terms of physical energy. Masterminding United's fitness is chief trainer Les Cocker, the man who gave the final polish to England's World Cup team. Every member of the playing staff is out this morning, and suffering with the lads are the chief coach Sid Owen, Bob English the Irish physiotherapist, and trainer Cyril Partridge. One group is enjoying a 5-minute break, so let's go over and meet, first of all, Paul Rennie.
I was born in London, but I'm called a local boy because I came to Leeds when I was only a fortnight old. I had a great start in with Leeds. The first year we ended up fifth, I think, in the second division, and from then on we've never looked back.
I remember Don saying to me, if you were to screw the nut and do the job right, you could play for England, you. And I sort of poo-pooed him. But I did. And we used to have arguments about whether, you know, I used to complain, when I go up for corner kicks, and you want me to go for corner kicks, because I'm quite good at it, and we get a lot of goals, not a fast score then, but off me. I said, I can't be responsible for what's happening at the back while I'm up the front. So instead of me, you know, if I miss a header, and then I've got to charge all the way back down the field again, pick up my position, and then if somebody scores, I'm responsible for it. Or if the break, and I'm not back, they blame me for it. I said, you can either one thing or another. Either I'll be a centre-back and not go up. And he said, well, I'd rather you be a centre-back. So I really fell out with Don over that, because I then became a centre-back. And I found the job of being a centre-back only very, very easy. It's not a position that you stress yourself very much. It's not a position where you're under a great deal of pressure that you can't handle. You're facing everything that comes at you. But for about 9, 8 months to a year, I fell out with Don and I wouldn't go up for corners.
Norman Hunter.
I am following in a family tradition. My dad played football for Sheffield Wednesday, and now I am playing for a Yorkshire club. I came down here and I was in digs with a few other lads, Terry Cooper for one, and a few other ones. And after being here 2.5 years, my mother was supposed really on her own, so the club said they'd get her a house, so she came down, and she's living down here now, and to keep her busy sort of thing, she's looking after some of the lads.